to thank Fosdem because it's a great place for sharing. And I think as we are doing technologies for sharing, it's a good idea today to do sharing. So I will talk about something called Forban. You can pronounce it with a French accent. Sorry for my French accent. But Forban is a play word between Forban like the pirates, but Forban like Forban, meaning banning on the internet. And I will explain all the background of the project is the 15 minutes I have. Basically, because the project is came out from some frustration I had. So the first thing that is very important, it's right now the legal framework, so the copyright law and so on, is basically limiting your ability to share information. And to share with your neighbor or your friends is becoming very complex and very difficult. And that's for us a very key point why we develop Forban, is we want something that we can share with friend and neighbor without too much difficulty. Another problem that we have seen is basically editors, so the one publishing books or publisher, are basically trying to kill off the conviviality in the society. So whatever you try to do for exchanging books and so on, they try to limit your capability of exchanging books. And worse, and I think Eben Moglen talk about it this morning, is the internet start to be controlled. So more and more laws are limiting your behavior on the internet. So for example, if you start to share on the internet, now you receive letter, and even worse, you get blocked from the internet. And I wanted to take the example of the books, because books are really a part of our society. For my personal point of view, I can't live without books. You can learn from it, you can learn science, you can learn engineering, you can escape from the world. It's a great thing. The thing is, books start to be a bit useless with those bloody DRM, the kind of digital restriction management tools, where basically the editor are pushing the limits and try to avoid all the nice functionality we had with physical books and limit people buying books and limit their ability to share books. So that's why we were wondering, because currently with physical book, it's very easy to go to a traditional library to get a book, to rent a book, to lend a book. It's very easy. Now, with digital books, is it easy? Is it more difficult? It starts to be very strange, because basically the library is not able anymore to share books. So I think we have to counterbalance this, that we have to maybe play the role of the librarians and transport by yourself all your books. And that was the crazy idea we had. So basically, Forban started as a discussion, you know, one of those crazy discussions between geeks. And the major question we had were the following. The first one was, can we do file sharing without the internet? And I think today it's very easy. Computers are everywhere. Each phone is basically a full-blown computer. So sharing starts to be very easy. Setting up a wireless network, so a personal area network, is very easy. Another thing that we discover, it's basically more easy to exchange or share books with strangers. Why? But you go to Usenet or you start your peer-to-peer client and you start to look for books. But basically the guys who are sharing books or girls who are sharing the books with you are basically strangers. Why is it not easier with your friends? Another thing we were wondering, if we start a new project, we want to start something very small and simple, and we don't want to start by a very complex project. Another thing we had in mind is security. Do we really care about security when we do file sharing? And it's something I really should not say about it, because I'm working in security. We completely forget about security, because it's, for us, a pain in the ass to handle and manage. So that's why we started to work on this project. And we wanted to make a very simple protocol when we have been very kind of proximity. So that means when you are close to a friend, how do you do sharing? Right now, when you are in a bookshelf or next to a bookshelf, you just share with your friends which kind of book you have. So you look at book cover and you exchange books. It's very straightforward. So that means the technology needs to be as simple. So that's why we created Forban. with some basic objective and some basic technical recommendations. First, we wanted to basically rely on the HTTP protocol without going into very complex stuff. We just had to add minimal extensions to do the announce, but basically it's full-blown HTTP. So you can use any HTTP client out there to access some forbound nodes. Something else that we didn't care too much in the initial prototype is bandwidth optimizations and so on. So that means if you have a forbound node, they will use all the bandwidth and they will do best effort. So for the first version, it might be sometimes unstable, but it's quite interesting to for designing the protocol. Something that we discussed too is we wanted to have something that is really independent from files, format, and file structure used. We want something that people are just putting file and it's automatically replicated. Something that is quite important, a lot of networks are basically unstable. That means they are going up and down very often. Wireless networks are used to be unstable. Maybe you see here at FOSDEM. It's very easy if you are not close away, very close to the access point. You might be not have wireless access, so it's basically unstable. So you have to take into consideration such kind of thing. And the idea is basically to have a prototype that can be re-implemented and even remixes. And that's very important for us. It's very it's an early experiment. So don't expect everything to work perfectly. But basically, we wanted to have really software, so we just implemented the idea. And afterwards, we hope that other people will create other versions and other ideas based on this idea. So as always I say, you can't blame us for what we are doing, but we are doing something. So if you see a problem, so if you want to improve the protocol, it's fine, it's great. But show us the code. So the core concept between forbound is different mode of operations, but the main mode is called the opportunistic mode. What is all about? The opportunistic mode is really, as the name stands, it's an opportunist. So that means he's sharing everything and he's copying everything. In the academic literature, you can see it as a well-known protocol called epidemic protocol or gossip protocol. So that's basically copying everything. There is another mode, shared mode, where you can share everything. Sorry. And you have another mode. Another mode. Great. And you have another mode where you can basically get any file you want. So all it looks like, it's very easy. What do you see? It's all the nodes available on the networks. Here you see one called Elliptic, and you see another one called Clarisma Clients. Each node has files that are basically books or whatever you want to share. They are seen IPv4 and IPv6. Like you can see basically the files missing between a lot. So this one is Clarisma Clients, and she's missing 567 files. That's how it works on the interface. Obviously, we are not user interface designer, but the idea is every node see each other. So to go maybe deeper into the systems, it's how it works. It's basically you are in a wireless network. You have two forbound nodes. One is using the opportunistic mode, that's the default mode. And one is using the shared mode, where it's basically sharing files, but without getting the files. So how does it work? That's very easy. The opportunistic mode is getting all the files from the shared one and stacking all the files. So that's basically a simple fetch and merge all the files. Imagine a third node is coming into the wireless, so basically it's entering the wireless networks. You see you have still the opportunistic ones, you have the shared mode one, and you have a node without any files. This one is going into the network and it will basically do the same thing as the previous one. You will see the two nodes, get all the content, and that's it. So that means each node is basically replicating all the content. That's very brute force, but it works. So as you see, no, the third node has all the files. It works even with a web browser. If you know where the forbin is, you can get and browse any directory you want. Or you browse it, it's very straightforward. You basically go to the interface, and you have here a small button, browse, and you can browse any files. So that means any web browser should work out of the box. How does it work? For the technical people over here, it's very simple. We have an announce protocol to just do the announce. I'm pretty sure I will get questions about this. Why don't we use rendezvous, DNSSD, and so on? It's basically because we wanted one single message containing all the information. So that means if the index is new, the source IP, and so on. Doing this with DNSSD or SSDP or any of those protocols, it's very complex. So that's basically a flooding protocol with just regularly flooding the network with a UDP frame in V4 and V6. Each forbin is known by a unique ID. This unique ID is randomly generated. It's flooding the networks. And each forbin is maintaining a list of all the ones it discovers. That's basically it. And afterwards, he knows how to get the index files. So he's basically using the HTTP protocol to get each file. So how does the format looks like? The format is basically no binary format. It's a full text format. So you have a source interface. That's basically where the announce is coming from. And the destination, you see we are using broadcast or multicast link local addresses for the announce. What's inside? Basically a header, it's called forbin, and you have a key value entry with the name of the forbin, the unique ID, and the hashmac. And the hashmac is basically the index hash of this forbin. If the index changes, it will be changed. Right now, the hashmac is hard-coded to one key, but it can be elaborated after to have private forbin with a specific network. Why we are doing this? It's basically a simple protocol. So that means you can have in one liner using TCP dump or Wireshark, whatever you want. So that means doing scripting around the protocol is very easy, because what you can do is you can filter on listen on any interface, get the payload, filter on the default port that we are using is 12.555, and look for the beginning of the UDP frame for forbin. That's it. And like that, you have what you have is a one-liner containing the announce. Easy. Afterwards, when you know how to reach a forbin, you can get the index. Or you get the index, you basically use the source IP addresses from the announce, use the default destination port that you get to, and you download the index. What is the index? It can be less more simple than that. It's basically a file path with a file name and the size of the files. That's it. What is the index? It's basically a text file containing recursively all the files available in the shared directory, the total files, and everyone can fetch this file, and the file is a text file without any limitations. It's a raw file, so it's not UTF encoded whatsoever. It's depending of what each node is doing. So that might be a problem in some case. How to get a file? Basically the same stuff. You get the files, it's a get method. You still use the information that you get from the source interface. You encode the file name from the index as a base64 URL safe encoder, and that's it, and you get the files. From the web interface, it works from the same way. You just have a content dispositions to make everyone happy. How works the opportunistic mode? This one is very simple too. It's basically comparing all the index, doing a diff of each index, and merging into a single file and downloading the files that are missing. That's basically it. Nothing very complex. You can build filters to extract some files, but the algorithm is not that much complex. If you look at the code, I think this part is around 25 lines of Python. So nothing else. So if you can do it in, you want to do it in Bash, Lua, or your favorite language, or your favorite scripting language, you can do it. That's pretty straightforward. There is something that's quite interesting that I think worth to mention is basically, as you see, the index is relying on file name. We don't look at the hash of the files. So that means, and that was a good question from TS, if you have files with basically the same file name, always you will keep only the largest file, and that's it. So, do you want to share at first them? So I have my library with me. I have around 4 GB of books. And that's it. So you have the informations.